How mineral deposits form. Minerals occur as normal components of rocks, either as essential rock-forming minerals, such as orthoclase in granite or calcite in limestone, or as accessory minerals that are present in small amounts evenly distributed throughout a rock. Minerals may also occur in local concentrations in abundances far higher than crustal norms. These local concentrations may be of varied composition, shape, size, and origin, and have the potential to become ore deposits. According to the definition of Stevens, 2010, a mineral deposit is a naturally occurring body of rock that hosts a concentration of valuable minerals or elements that may be extracted at a profit. At a profit is a key part of this definition, and we will be exploring the factors that influence the profitability of a mineral deposit later in the course. The presence of a mineral deposit indicates that some kind of geological process or combination of processes has taken place in the crust to focus and concentrate minerals or elements. At average crustal abundances, the concentration of valuable elements are too low to extract at a profit. This table illustrates the average crustal abundances for a number of different commodities and the concentration factors required to make them economic. For some very rare elements, concentration factors are up to 5,000 times average crustal abundance, so these elements must be concentrated to a level at which they can be mined. There are five main mineralizing processes that take place in the crust to concentrate elements: hydrothermal, magmatic, sedimentary, placer, and residual. Let's look at these in more detail. All the mineralizing processes have three basic requirements. There needs to be a source of metals and minerals, some mechanism by which those metals and minerals are transported, and some means by which the minerals are trapped and concentrated. These components differ depending on the type of mineralizing process that is taking place. For example, the source of metals and minerals may be crustal rocks, cooling magma, or the mantle. Minerals and elements can be transported by hot water circulating through the crust, by magma moving through the crust, or by groundwater, as an example. Deposition commonly takes place as the result of a physical or chemical change to the fluid. A change in temperature or pressure can affect the solubility of elements dissolved in hot water, for example, or a chemical reaction may facilitate precipitation. In the case of placer deposits, changing velocity of groundwater will cause gold grains or diamonds to fall out of suspension. Hydrothermal processes are the most important of all of the ore-forming processes and lead to a diverse range of mineral deposits in different crustal environments. Hydrothermal means hot water and refers to mineral deposits that are formed by precipitating from hot fluids that circulate through the crust. Hydrothermal fluids dissolve and carry metals such as gold, silver, copper, lead, and zinc that have been derived from other crustal rocks. These fluids travel via temperature or pressure gradients from zones of high pressure or temperature to zones of low temperature or pressure, or along crustal structures until they reach a suitable trap site. Hydrothermal mineral deposits are diverse and form disseminated, vein, breccia, and massive deposits depending on the environment of formation. Hydrothermal deposits are typically associated with magmatic activity and will often be located adjacent to magma chambers. They are often associated with geothermal features such as geysers, mud pools, and fumaroles. This video shows Champagne Pool at the Waiatapu Geothermal Field in New Zealand. The pool is about 70 degrees Celsius and gets its name from the carbon dioxide exhaling from the water, which gives the pool its champagne fizz appearance. The orange crust around the edge of Champagne Pool is composed of opalmint and stibnite, which are arsenic and antimony sulfides, and contains approximately 100 grams per ton gold. The Waiatapu geothermal field is considered by researchers to be a modern analog of ancient epithermal hydrothermal mineral deposits. Mineral precipitation takes place in the crust as a result of physical or chemical changes to the fluid. When temperatures decrease, minerals become less soluble and precipitate out of solution. This is very common at black smokers when hot hydrothermal fluids are expelled into cold ocean water, resulting in the formation of sulfide chimneys.
Hydrothermal vents are essentially hot springs under the ocean. The main place that we find these high temperature hydrothermal vents is along the mid-ocean ridge system, which is in fact the longest chain of volcanoes we have on our planet. The water is sufficiently hot that it could probably melt many metals. And so this is water that is able to be superheated because of the overlying pressure of the ocean water above, because you have to remember that the ocean, particularly in these places where there are volcanoes along the mid-ocean ridge, are perhaps 2,000 to 4,000 meters deep. So the way hydrothermal vents work is that cold seawater percolates down into the lava along a mid-ocean ridge. And as it does so, it gets heated up because of the volcanic heat from below, and it rises back to the surface and forms this black smoker chimney with this very hot fluid, black fluid coming out the top. And these chimney structures form a deposit that's made of copper, iron, and zinc sulfides. So this is a hydrothermal vent that you can see the black smoke, or rather fluid, that comes out of these vents. It's black because the color is due to minerals of copper and iron and zinc sulfides precipitating out of that hot fluid. And those minerals form these large chimney structures made of sulfide minerals that would ultimately form a mineral deposit on the seafloor. Vents are important for several different reasons. We mine large ore deposits on land for copper and iron and other elements. It turns out that many of those deposits that we mine actually formed on the ocean floor. And the reason we know this is because even though they're now on land, they're in pieces of crust that we can identify as ocean crust. Those deposits are all very old. Now that we have seen hydrothermal vents, we can actually look at how those mineral deposits form, and that might help us look for new deposits in the future.
Rapid pressure decreases take place when rocks fracture or when fluids enter open cavities, which significantly reduces the lithostatic pressure exerted on the fluid. Rapid pressure decreases result in phase separation of the mineralized fluid into a liquid and a vapor phase. This process is commonly referred to as boiling, although it is not boiling in the strictest sense. Elements can't remain dissolved in the vapor phase, resulting in oversaturation of the liquid phase and subsequent precipitation. Minerals can also precipitate when fluids react with wall rocks, such as limestone or iron-bearing rocks that contain magnetite. Gold, which is commonly transported as a bisulfite complex, is precipitated when the gold-bearing fluid interacts with magnetite. The sulfur reacts with magnetite to form pyrite, and the gold, which is no longer soluble, precipitates out of solution. In this example, from the New Celebration orogenic gold deposit in Western Australia, gold that was transported as a bisulfide complex in hydrothermal fluids reacted with magnetite in the dolerite host rock to form gold-bearing pyrite. The image on the left shows disseminated pyrite in a sheared vein. The image on the right is a magnification of two pyrite crystals that contain tiny gold grains. Examples of hydrothermal deposits include volcanic-hosted magmatic sulfide deposits, which form around black smokers and are valuable sources of copper, lead, zinc, and gold; epithermal deposits, which form some of the richest gold and silver deposits in the world; porphyry copper deposits; and orogenic lode gold deposits. You will explore the details of these and other types of mineral deposits later in the course. Magmatic processes result in the concentration of all forming minerals as a consequence of chemical and mineralogical processes in magma. Magmatic ore deposits form through the differentiation of magma chambers or lava flows through fractional crystallization or liquid sulfide immiscibility. The differentiation process forms layers of varying composition and density and is the mechanism by which many of the world's nickel, chromite, and PGE deposits form. Liquid sulfide immiscibility is the process by which magma becomes supersaturated with sulfur. Sulfide droplets form in the magma chamber and attract nickel, copper, and platinum group elements to them. These sulfide droplets are denser than the surrounding silicate magma and sink to the bottom, forming a layer of massive sulfide that contains economic concentrations of nickel, copper, and platinum group elements. During fractional crystallization, dense minerals crystallize in the magma chamber and sink to the bottom due to density contrasts. This creates a layered intrusion and causes the remaining magma to become enriched in sulfur. Sulfide minerals rich in platinum group elements crystallize out of the magma and sink to the bottom to form reefs of PGE rocks. In this case, magma is both the source and the fluid, and density contrasts facilitate precipitation. Examples of magmatic layered intrusions include the Bushveld complex in South Africa, which is mined for platinum group elements, and Sudbury, which is primarily a nickel-copper deposit. This image shows PGE-bearing chromatite layers in the Bushveld complex in South Africa. The alternating light and dark layers are formed by new influxes of magma into the magma chamber, resulting in multiple episodes of differentiation. Magmatic differentiation can also occur in lava flows, and led to the formation of kimmatite-hosted nickel deposits in Western Australia. Kimmatites are a unique group of magnesium-rich rocks that formed from high-temperature ultramafic lavas during the Archean, when the mantle and crustal geothermal gradients were much higher than they are today. Kimmatites are dominated by olivine and pyroxene and form a characteristic spinifex texture, as seen in the image on the left. The photograph on the right shows a thick band of nickel sulfide at the base of an altered kimmatite. Sedimentary processes are those that result from chemical precipitation of minerals from lake or seawater. The precipitation mechanism depends on the mineral, but most typically occurs as a result of evaporation or chemical reaction. Evaporites form when mineral deposits are left behind after the evaporation of lake or seawater. Salts, such as halite, potash, and gypsum, are examples of evaporites. Banded iron formations are also the result of sedimentary processes and formed by chemical reactions with oxygen in formerly anoxic environments. Banded iron formations, which are the world's largest source of iron ore, formed between 2.6 and 1.9 billion years ago as the planet experienced changes to its atmosphere. In an anoxic environment, iron dissolves readily in water, so during the Archean, large quantities of iron were dissolved in the oceans. With the proliferation of photosynthesizing plants during the Paleoproterozoic, oceanic oxygen increased and iron oxides, such as magnetite and hematite, which are not soluble, precipitated out of solution. Placer processes are those that concentrate minerals deposited by water or ice and are essentially clastic sedimentary processes facilitated by fluvial or glaciofluvial activity. Fluvial systems are rarely straight. Rather, streams meander along the path of least resistance. Water velocity and stream depth change depending on stream morphology. Water flows more rapidly around outside curves, eroding material from the riverbanks, and slows down on inside curves, resulting in the deposition of material that can no longer be held in suspension. Heavy minerals such as gold and magnetite fall out of suspension in these areas to form placer deposits. In this case, the source is an eroding gold deposit, the transport mechanism is the stream, and the trap is the point bar. One of the most famous placer deposits in Canada is the Klondike in the Yukon. The discovery of gold in 1896 by three local prospectors triggered the Klondike gold rush of 1897-1898 near Dawson City. The area is still actively mined for placer gold. Residual processes are those where concentration of the valuable elements results from the removal of waste material by weathering and erosion. Residual ore-forming processes concentrate ore by removing waste material and leaving behind only the valuable minerals. In this example, bauxite, which is the principal source of aluminium, is left behind after all the soluble ions have been removed from the surrounding soil and rock. This typically occurs in tropical areas with very high rainfall and warm temperatures in a process known as lateritization. This process also concentrates nickel in ultramafic rocks that have been extensively weathered in areas such as Australia and New Caledonia. Supergene enrichment occurs when surface or groundwater dissolves metals in the upper parts of a deposit and reprecipitates them at depth. This leaves a leached zone at the surface, but results in significantly higher grades in the enriched zone below the water table. This process is particularly significant in porphyry copper deposits and can improve the economic viability of a deposit, although it may pose some metallurgical challenges. The image on the left is a gold sample from the supergene zone at the Gold Flake Mine, Colorado. In summary, ore deposits form when crustal processes concentrate valuable elements in concentrations far above average crustal norms. Mineral deposits form as a result of hydrothermal, magmatic, sedimentary, placer, or residual processes, but each share three basic requirements: a source of metal, a means by which the metal can be transported, and a trap or deposition mechanism. You will investigate examples of these deposit types later in the course.